Now let's talk about long-run production. Long-run production. OK. Now in the long run, all inputs are variable. That's how we define the long run. So now a firm doesn't just choose how many workers to hire or how many hours of labor to buy. It chooses both L and K and has to trade them off, just like you chose both pizza and movies and had to trade them off. Okay? So the long run production theory is the same as utility, basically the same mechanics as utility theory. There's a production function. You have two inputs. You trade them off. Just like you're a consumer, you have two goods to consume. You trade them off. The difference is going to be that ultimately production is going to itself. The difference is when you decide how to trade them off as a consumer, you're given a budget constraint. The difference with production is this is actually going to determine, the budget constraint is going to be itself determined by the same system. So we're not only going to develop your production function, but you're going to develop your budget constraint. You're going to decide both. It's a little bit funky, but we'll get to it. But for now, let's just think about the parallels with consumer theory and think about a production function, which is q, little q, is the square root of k times l. That same functional form I used with pizza and movies, where utility was the square root of pizza times movies. Now I'm going to say what you produce of your good is the square root of k times l. Now let's go to figure 8.3. Okay? And what we see here is if you're trading off k and l and deciding to produce, then you get what's called isoquants. Isoquants are the parallel to indifference curves. Once again, this is all the same mechanics. Just as there were sets of goods across which you were indifferent, two pizzas in one movie versus one pizza in two movies, isoquants are sets of inputs along which production is the same. So along given isoquant, Q is fixed. Each of those isoquants is a different level of Q. But they show how you can vary K and L to get the same amount of Q. Okay, so produce Q equals square root of 2. I can either use 2 units of capital and 1 unit of labor, or 1 unit of capital and 2 units of labor. Okay, so I can choose lots of combinations of K and L along that isoquant to produce a given amount of output. And isoquants have all the same features of indifference curves. The further out, the better, because you're producing more. They can't cross. All the same set of things we have with indifference curves are true with isoquants as well. Okay? And they slope downwards, okay, because there's a trade-off between capital and labor. Now, what's going to determine the slope of an isoquant? Could someone tell me? What determines the slope of an isoquant? Likewise, the substitutability between labor and capital will determine the slope of these isoquants. In that case, you would have a linear isoquant. Because what that would mean is you don't care if you have 3 capital and 1 labor, or 3 labor and 1 capital. You don't care. Okay? You just have or you don't care if you have 2 labor and 2 capital or 3 labor and 1 capital. As long as you have a total of 4, that's all that matters. The perfectly substitutable inputs, which would say that it would be something like Q equals K plus L, would be a case of perfectly substitutable inputs. You don't care if it's K or L, you just care about the total. That'd be perfectly substitutable inputs. That would be a linear isoquant. Okay? On the other hand, let's think about goods which are not at all substitutable, like cereal and cereal boxes. Okay? The cereal doesn't do any good unless you have a box to put it in. The box doesn't do any good unless you have cereal to put in it. That would be like an 8.4b. 8.4b would show you non-substitutable inputs, where basically it doesn't matter how much, basically given an amount of one input, it doesn't matter how much you have of the other. So for example, if you take these are called, we call these non-substitutable isoquants Leontief production functions. A Leontief production function for Vasily Leontief, some old economist. Okay? And basically, what a Leontief production function is that your production, Q equals the min of K and L, is a Leontief production function. So given how much K you have, Given you have 10 cereal boxes, once you have 10 chunks of cereal, it doesn't matter if you have 10, 11, 12, a million. You only have 10 cereal boxes. Okay? So given an amount of k, then it doesn't matter how much L you have. Once you get to the amount of L you need to fill the cereal boxes, it doesn't matter, and vice versa. Okay? So basically, perfectly substitutable, they're perfectly non-substitutable. So all that determines your output is which you have the least of. Okay? So substitutabilities determine the slope of the isoquants and of this production function. Okay? Now in general, we'll be in between these cases. There'll be some substitutability. Goods won't be perfectly substitutable, but they'll be somewhat substitutable. Okay? So in general, we'll be in between these cases. And more generally, just as the slope of the indifference curve is the marginal rate of substitution, the slope of the isoquant we will call the marginal rate of technical substitution. The marginal rate of technical substitution, the rate at which you can substitute one input for another in a production function, is the marginal rate of technical substitution. Okay? Which we'll define, the marginal rate of substitution we'll define as delta K, delta L, for a given Q bar. Okay? The rate at which you can trade off K for L to hold Q bar fixed. Okay? Now, as with marginal rates of substitution, the marginal rate of technical substitution will change along the isoquant. So if you go to figure 8.5, okay, here we've drawn a typical isoquant for the production function Q equals square root of K times L. Okay? So the production function is Q equals square root of K times L, and here's an isoquant. This is the isoquant of all combinations which produce two units. So this is the Q equals 2 isoquant. Okay? Now, unlike utility, remember utility, we said where U equals 2 was meaningless. Utility was an ordinal concept, not a cardinal concept. Here, quantity is meaningful. If you produce 4, you've literally produced twice as much if you produce 2. We can care about both the ordinality and the cardinality of these outcomes. So we could say, what are the combinations of inputs which lead you to produce 2 units? Well, it's all these combinations of inputs. So for instance, you can have 1 unit of labor and 4 units of capital, 2 of each, or 4 units of labor and 1 unit of capital. All will produce 2 units of the output. And what you can see is that the marginal rate of technical substitution varies. So for instance, when we start with 4 units of capital and 1 unit of labor, okay, and we think about adding a second unit of labor, okay, then the marginal rate of technical substitution is minus 2. That is, 1 unit of labor is worth 2 units of capital. In other words, we can produce the same amount of widgets of Q, okay, but if we replace 2 units of capital with 1 unit of labor. So at that point, we're very capital intensive. A next unit of labor is very valuable. On the other hand, now if we were imagined down at 4.1, at the third point, we ought to probably label this ABC. Okay, you're now at that third point where you have 4 units of labor and 1 unit of capital. Okay, now you'd be willing to give up 2 units of labor just to get 1 unit of capital. That is, the marginal rate of technical substitution is now minus a half. When you're very labor intensive, you'd be happy to give up a lot of labor to get a little capital. Okay? Once again, the principle of diminishing marginal product, just like the principle of diminishing marginal utility, implies that the marginal rate of technical substitution is going to be falling as you go down the isoquant. Okay? Just like the marginal rate of substitution fell as you went down the indifference curve, the marginal rate of technical substitution is going to fall as you go down the isoquant. Okay? And why is this? Once again, it's because of this diminishing marginal productivity. That is, as you add more and more labor, given capital, each unit of labor can do less and less. And likewise, you add more and more capital, given an amount of workers to use it, each unit of capital can do less and less. So it's the same, it's a very different approach, but gets you the same answer, which is with consumption, each piece it did less and less for you, but we can sort of see that as consumers. Okay, here are the notions with labor. Each worker does less and less for you, holding capital fixed. And each machine, by the same logic, if you have one guy at a hole, it doesn't matter how many shovels you throw there, he still goes only one guy. So each machine's doing less and less by the same logic. And that those diminishing marginal products leads to this decreasing marginal rate of technical substitution as you move along the isoquant.